I feel like a lot of people kind of conform themselves to what they think people will like, when really that's not who they are. If you do anything different from the standard social norm, it's considered weird.
First met Lily, I was talking about art. She said, oh yeah, I love domino art. And I was like, wait, what?
I started the channel when I was literally like 9 or 10 years old.
And now my channel has over 1.9 million subscribers. It teaches you patience, geometry, it teaches you physics.
To my knowledge, Lily is the only professional domino artist who is a girl.
And there's so many builders that have learned from her.
Not a single domino out of place, not a single one.
I knew from a very early age that I was adopted.
She was left at the doorstep of an orphanage in China. And she was very afraid that she would be abandoned again.
Lily, love you.
I love you.
Being in college, it's actually like the happiest I've been because I've met so many amazing people, but I can't build here.
If I could stay, I really would.
How do you balance what you want to do than what your audience expects from you?
Luke, do you want a hug?
Yeah. It's so great to meet you finally.
I'm like shaking.
This is Lily.
Hi.
I'm a huge fan of your stuff.
I think in the past, I just didn't know how to be me because I didn't know who I was.
Hi to the camera.
Domino champ.
Go.
This is crazy.
Yes!
I feel like I've found myself because of dominoes.
This has been the dream. I can't even believe I'm finally saying this.
This documentary shares a much more personal and vulnerable side of me that you may not have seen in my videos, and I'm excited to share that with you, to show you the real Lily behind the scenes and behind the five, and this really means a lot to me. This documentary is my life from the past 3 years. So much has changed, so much has happened, and I am just so excited to share it with you. You can stream it on August 26th on Discovery Plus. Thank you for watching. Thank you everyone who has supported the domino community and my journey. And as always, I'm Lily Hevesh, and keep on building. I'm a movie star now.
But I'm not trying to be like a YouTube star, obviously. I don't think that's in any of the cards either.
Right. So yeah, I mean, you probably saw what it means to be a YouTube star slash creator when you had, when you watched the movie.
Right. But I kind of feel like with Lily, as your documentary, Lily Topples the World, shows that's the YouTube component to it is a secondary byproduct. It's like she's doing these projects. Her goal is just to show the world what she's doing. Getting the YouTube following is just sort of happens as a result of that if you do it really well. I don't get the sense like other YouTube stars, and not all of them, of course, I wouldn't know, but a lot of them go in wanting to build a following. They find out that's their goal.
Right. Yeah, interesting about Lily is that, you know, she came to YouTube as an artist first.
Right.
You know, she was making her domino art and she was passionate about being an artist. And then YouTube like was an entry into that world, or the dominoes were an entry into the YouTube world. And then that led her to become this sort of YouTube creator. But I always had the feeling, even when I was making the movie, that if she wasn't doing YouTube, she'd still be doing domino art.
Right. And also allowed her to find a way to monetize doing domino or it's a great opportunity to be able to monetize it. It must be very difficult before YouTube to know really how to monetize. It must have been a lot trickier.
I mean, no question. The notable domino artists that predate Lily, and some are like really, you know, way back when in the 70s and 80s, and they were on Johnny Carson and they were on That's Incredible. There's an older guy, you know, they didn't have YouTube. So they just were hoping that they'd get booked on Sesame Street. And YouTube has obviously created this incredible forum for artists like Lily, but not just Lily. I mean, there's thousands of them doing all kinds of art. Some of them is traditional art and some non-traditional art. And what that's done is it's kind of created this incredible community where she found her people on YouTube. And I thought that was also really, that's really cool. And
it is cool. Yeah, I appreciate that part of it. And which
kind of like a weird positive about social media. You know, we always hear how bad social media is, and yet this is not that story.
I don't think that social media would exist if there wasn't a connective aspect that was constructive or gratifying on a personal connective level. It's just like you got to get all the garbage that comes along with it. Obviously, there's a lot of nefarious types who have tried to exploit the social media for, you know, a gain. Obviously.
Yeah. I mean, going on that point, I mean, I was intrigued. I mean, first of all, we've all seen and know all these movies and documentaries that, you know, are about the travesty of how awful social media is, you know, and like Social Dilemma, for example.
Which had the cinematographers on for that.
Oh, yeah. That's an incredible movie. It's so well shot, too.
And that's why I was very excited. And it's a hybrid, right?
Yeah, it is. It's really well, like they really pulled out all the stops when they shot that movie. But, you know, I was sort of blown away by how Lily was... like at the opposite side of all this, where she was doing all this sort of kind of inspiring and stuff and showcasing her art and finding this community that was out there.
Right.
And that was a big kind of theme in the movie that really wanted to kind of get into.
Well, it might've been enough. I don't mean this to sound cynical at all, but it might've been enough of an impetus to have a huge YouTube star. Like how many followers, when you started this?
So I filmed the movie for over 3 years, right? And when I started, Lily was in a freshman in college and she was 19 years old.
And you're here, I'm not too far north of where I am actually, been to Rensselaer.
Yeah, she went to RPI College, Rensselaer.
Troy,
College.
New York.
Yeah, in Troy. And so that's where the movie like picks her up. In fact, the movie like opens with her at college. Literally, she's a teenager. I mean, technically a teenager. She's 19. And I started filming her in college, following her, and just kind of showed up at her dorms, you know, once we had decided to make a documentary together, you know, just kind of showed up and started filming her. Then filmed her for like 3 years after that. And, but yeah, I forgot.
It's not a spoiler. It's okay. I can help. It's not a spoiler to say that she decided to quit college.
Exactly.
Focus full time on her art.
Exactly. So one of the big first act, you know, big dilemmas for Lily that we follow in the film is that she is getting more and more opportunities as a domino artist. And, she has to kind of decide whether she wants to stay in college. And it becomes that, you know, classic, should she follow this sort of traditional route as what we all do on the treadmill, you know, going to college and trying to get a job, or should she really take this plunge into this world of being a YouTuber, being a domino artist, and trying to be a professional, of which there's maybe 10 in the world, you know?
Yeah, crazy.
Yeah. And so the movie tracks her from the beginning of her in college to
this part of her journey.
Exactly.
Like, right. But before we get mm-hmm. I want to take just a baby step backward too, just to ask you as an artist, or as a filmmaker of artists often, you obviously see a built-in audience, right? I'm not being cynical. I'm just asking questions, but I was wondering the way into this, because her following obviously has even grown probably tremendously in the last 3 years, and maybe even the film then introduced her to more.
Sure, sure.
You know, is even helping more, and now the film's gonna come out to even a bigger audience, right? It's gonna stream. And
yeah, it's coming out pretty widely. So, answer your question, and I remember.
Just tell that. The day that it's.
Yeah, so, it's coming out August 26th.
Okay.
And it's streaming on Discovery Plus, and you can find it everywhere. And it's also coming out in theaters in New York City August 27th. So I don't know when you're going to run this podcast, but August even if 20, it's...
Yeah, right. The day it's available so people can see it.
Even if it's, after, it'll be available to stream on Discovery Plus.
So within a day or two with the use
of the end of the month. Just to finally answer your question, when I started filming Lily, I think she had about 1.7, 1.8 million followers on YouTube. So I was super, right from the get-go, I was super intrigued at this idea of a YouTube creator, one with notable success, who was now at college and what that looked like. And then lo and behold, she decides to drop out of college. And then the movie follows this next these next chapters of her life and her career. Now she has close to 3.5 million followers. So it has really jumped even over the course of the film, the filming.
So, but did you think as a business person yourself, like, oh my goodness, it's like some of the work's done already. Because obviously distribution is always tricky.
Yeah.
But if I was a distributor and you came to me and you said, she's got 3 million people following her, I'd be excited to distribute your film.
Sure. So that was sort of in the back of my mind. It wasn't in the front of my mind, but it was definitely in the back of my mind. Like, wow, there's going to be interest in this movie. Right. Even if I just, put a camera in front of Lily and press record for 90 minutes.
Or just patch together some of her YouTube videos.
Yeah, I just we just kind of filmed some crappy documentary on her. There'll still probably be interest because she has, so many fans. But, once you get into it, I think the approach was very much that, let's try to steer a little away from your persona online, and let's really dig into the person. And I think that was the approach a little bit.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's interesting because she's demure, she's soft-spoken,
mm-hmm.
but she's doing these big, loud, destructive. I mean, the thing about dominoes, right? It's like art making, but this may be one of the very few instances where the idea is to kind of destruct the piece you make.
Yeah,
there's something very unusual, but so it's a very, it's only exists in a moment, in some of these very elaborate ones, it could be 15 minutes of a self-destructive, but I like this idea that she, the film explores kind of her doing quite well with Jimmy Fallon, with the Today Show guys, mm-hmm. with no matter where you put her, she seems to have she's able to create this confidence. And then she's got a crew filming the crew who are filming her for the show.
Yeah, it was very meta because here she is, doing these things. Sometimes they're interviewing her. Sometimes shooting that. She's sometimes filming her own domino videos for YouTube. I'm often filming that, and you sometimes using her footage. So there's all this sort of layers of kind of self-meta, self-reflexivity, which it's very YouTube-y, that's kind of the YouTube feel a little bit. But another thing that I think I was really I think the beginning, and this kind of gets a little to what you're saying, I think the beginning we were all like, oh, this is a portrait of an artist who's on YouTube. And then over the course of the filming, though, we started realizing that the movie maybe was a little different. It was more of a, maybe a little bit more of a coming of age movie. It still obviously is about the portrait of an artist who does stuff on YouTube, but it also has these elements of it being a coming of age movie.
I have so many questions. I would be so perfect if Lily was here, because I have such, now as I talk to you, Jeremy.
Yeah. Nobody wants to hear from me, you know.
Well, I always like hearing from you, but
yeah.
But
so
I'm just saying, I so rarely when you do one of your films, I've never had. I mean, I've gotten a little.
Wait, spoiled. That's not true. You've.
No, I was going to say the last film, I got a little spoiled by it, so now I kind of feel like I should get access to, you know, because then she Lily could answer all sorts of questions.
How can we get? Maybe we could. I don't know.
Oh, yeah.
Well, wait a second. Who's this?
Surprise!
What?
Hello.
Hi! Wow.
Here I am.
Okay, here I'm putting the headphones on her.
Oh, right. You can't both talk at once.
We probably can if we figure it out.
Can't you just
heckle? Here, have a
seat. The camera?
No, have a seat.
Okay.
Look, hi, Lily.
We're like bloopers.
Lily Hevesh.
Hi. Thank you so much for having me.
No, come. Thank you for doing it. So it's a lovely. It's so nice. I rewatched today. And, you know, I thought, I'm just going to shuttle through this documentary because I don't need to see the whole thing again. I saw it a few weeks ago. But, you know, when I don't watch it again, then I'll sometimes, when I do this, I'll just forget small details that really actually spark, you know, important things I want to talk about. So I was really glad to see it. And one thing that, you know, that I'm interested in, and I don't know how often you get asked about it, which is this idea of art versus commerce, because you're doing two things at once. You're an artist, you're a domino artist, you're a toppler, right? And and also simultaneously, you're a social media star, you're a YouTube star, or right, you know, influencer, what have you. So, and I'm wondering, like, it seems like I was talking to Jeremy about it, that YouTube gave you a great opportunity to be able to monetize and also your work, but also to connect and meet others. So for you, how do you juggle these two parts of what you're doing?
Right. Yeah, I mean, with YouTube now, that it has become more of like a full-time career for me. I do have to think about both, like, how do I balance that end of it while also just making great art and like doing that. And at the moment, it's like I can't focus on one or the other. It's like I always have to be thinking about both simultaneously. And, you know, sometimes it's challenging because, you know, maybe I want to make a really large domino project that has like everything I've always dreamed of, but I can't maybe spend 5 months in my house doing one project, although I would love to do something like that. And then on the other hand, it's like, well, I can't just do corporate projects all the time, because if I just post sponsored video after sponsored video on my channel, it's just, you know, my viewers are not going to really like that as much. It's not going to be as innovative. It's not going to be as creative as my own personal
grassroots
projects.
Organic. Yeah.
Right. So it's finding that balance between the two and incorporating some, you know, sponsored things in a very authentic way that, you know, maybe because of the topic, it's good for my channel, or, you know, maybe through my agency, you know, we have other domino builders who can carry out projects that I might not personally have time for. Mm-hmm. So we've been doing some workarounds and trying to structure the Hevesh Fab company in a way that we can still maintain the business and also allow more time for me to make my own personal projects on the side here and there.
What was the, when you made the choice, it's early in the film, so it's not necessarily a spoiler, but you decided to leave school. By the way, I'm not that far south of Troy.
Yeah.
I'm just south of Hudson, New York.
Nice.
So you know where I am, right?
I do, yep.
And I'm right on the Hudson here. So anyway, but you, when you decided to quit school, which I'm sure was a huge choice of yours, and I know it was an emotional choice, what were you thinking about, like, as far as at that point, how would you, were you thinking about, well, I need to spend full time and really take the big leap in so I can make a living at this, or is there something else going on? Because that's what I thought.
Right. I think at that time, when I was trying to make that decision to leave college or not, I was mostly thinking about, well, if I don't do this, am I going to regret it later on? And every situation is like, yes, I would have regretted not taking the leap. Thinking like, well, maybe if I did go to college for all 4 years, then my channel would have died. Like I've built up this huge domino thing on YouTube, and to see that crumble after years of work would really make me so sad to even think about. So in that situation, it's like, I don't want to live with regret. I always want to take an opportunity if it presents itself and it seems like it's gonna work or has a chance of working. So I just went for it. I threw myself into full-time domino art and haven't really looked back, you know. It was a good decision for me.
Well, it's great that you have that certainty and confidence. You know, speaking of confidence, because you come through as kind of not shy, but just almost like demure. Maybe there is shyness there too, but you have this ability to kind of turn something on where this confidence comes through, where you can hold your own with like pretty big, you know, mm-hmm. time folks like Jimmy Fallon, the guys at the Today Show, Casey Neistat, I know, yeah. Et cetera. Like, you know, whereas the other people might have been like, you know, like some of the guys that actually had a response when they met you, some of your fans.
Yeah, yeah.
You get nervous and where did that come from?
You know, I try not to get like too high on any opportunity that I do or like fangirl over people. Cause like being in the YouTube space, I've realized like everyone is literally just a human. Like you can watch you can watch someone's videos and like idolize them or whatever. But like at the end of the day, they're just like you. And like, I don't want people to idolize me in that way. I just want them to see who I am as a person. So right. I think having that mindset, like it reverses when I go to meet someone like Jimmy Fallon,
you know? Where you can just be yourself. But then there might be like millions of people watching you on the lights are on. You just sort of feel like you psyched yourself into this.
Yeah, yeah. It's funny because like even in the scene, like when we're in the Brattleboro Museum, there's like a big crowd watching next to the dominoes. Like I remember in those moments, it's although there might be like hundreds of people around me, it's like I can't even see them. Like all I'm focusing on is the dominoes. I need to make sure the dominoes look good, make sure everything's gonna work, everything's in the right place. It's like I don't even like they're there, but I don't like see them until I'm like good with the setup. I know everything's right. Then I'll go and be like, okay, now I can like bring in the world to watch it with me, you know? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What was the longest time it took to set up one of your, I know this is probably the most typical question you get, but what is just for my own?
The longest project that I've done, I believe it took 3 months to build 32,000 dominoes, which is my personal record.
And it went off okay?
There were a couple of hiccups here and there, but you know, you can't really tell in the main video because I've edited it.
I see. Okay. Yeah. Very good. And, okay. So now tell me, did you have any trepidations about, somebody going into your life? Did you watch Jeremy's films? You know that he wasn't just going to be telling your, you know, rise to fame. It was also going to be a kind of a personal documentary about you too. Was that something that you were nervous about or that you were hesitating over?
I don't think I like had any super big worries. I mean, going into it, like, of course it's a documentary. So like, I understand he's gonna wanna talk about my life and like outside of YouTube and my upbringing, which I think that just comes with the nature of making a documentary. So that was very understood to me. And, you know, just seeing, I think Jeremy's approach in making films was very good, because it made me feel relaxed in the sense that, like, he didn't have a huge crew. It was mostly just him filming as a behind the scenes cameraman. And I think taking that approach made it easier to kind of open up in a way and share a more personal side of me as well.
Mm. Well, you seem like a very, obviously you're very level-headed person, but you also seem to be very thoughtful and even keeled. So when these things happen, I mean, there must be things you've decided not to do, right? Like, were there other opportunities you turned down? Did anybody ever approach you? Anybody else ever approach you about doing like a film about your work?
A couple of people have actually like asked while he was filming the documentary. So of course, I was like,
"What was your answer?
We can't do those."
Yeah.
Well, we're already making a film.
Let me just tell you something. It hasn't stopped others, because I actually know of a case where somebody was shooting, I think it was Steve Bannon. Do you know what I'm talking about, right?
I don't think so, actually.
Okay, well, he was like one of the Trump's advisors and close associates. And then there were these people making a documentary about him. And then they found out at a certain point that there was another crew also making a film about him.
And he
didn't tell either other party, yeah. So no, I know you wouldn't have done that. I'm just, the film is coming out in a matter of days. Yep. Are you excited? You must be excited.
Yeah,
about that.
I'm so excited. Yeah. I mean, it's not just going to be in theaters, but also like streaming on Discovery Plus. So a huge like range of people can see it now. Like, you don't have to be in a certain area necessarily. Just like if you have Discovery Plus or get the trial, like anyone can watch it.
And you designed, well, I don't know if I want to talk about this. Ask Jeremy, should we talk about that part of the film? I don't know. Like, it's good to have some things, you know.
Wait, Jeremy's not even here.
Did he?
Jeremy!
It's okay. There's another level to the entrepreneurial stuff that happens, right? Like, mm-hmm. you know, with, I mean, hey, oh, there he is. Did we want to talk about did we want to talk about her designing dominoes? Do you want to leave some things
on? About the design dominoes?
Or do we?
Go for it.
Yeah. Yeah, you said go for it.
Make it more, but wait, is he unplugged?
Yeah.
No, he's there.
Oh,
yeah.
But yeah, and talk about how connected to the movie.
Okay.
And what
sounds
we see
good.
In the movie.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, the only reason I brought it up, the idea that you're also an entrepreneur and that you are very, very sophisticated, I thought, in those meetings, in the sense of, and I don't mean this to patronize you because of your young age, but like, you know, again, here you are with people that are double, twice your age, sometimes even older, and yet there seemed to be just this strong sense of confidence that you had.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Yeah.
Well, it's not even you're welcome. I mean, I'm glad it's a compliment. It is a compliment, but I'm just still kind of curious as to where you are able to pull that from. Whereas people, again, that are much older than you and don't even have that, they would freak out by some of those experiences you were. They'd crumble like your dominoes. They would just topple over.
I think it all comes down to the passion that I have for dominoes and the vision that I see with it. I'm very confident in, you know, what dominoes can do and how it could be expanded to the world and can help people and teach people all these things like patience and geometry. And there's just so much opportunity with domino art. And I 100%, 200% believe in that. And, you know, I think just having such confidence in the vision, I'm able to present myself in a way that makes me look or appear more confident in those situations. But, you know, I'm not like that in other aspects of my life. But with dominoes, at least, it's like I'm very sure of what I want, and I know how I can get there. It's just I gotta get other people on board with it.
Right. That makes complete sense. That's a great answer. Exactly. I get it now. Awesome. I get it now. So if you can only take that same sense of vision to other areas of your life, you're gonna be you're gonna be just fine, right?
That's the goal. That's the goal.
It's a good goal.
Yeah.
And it's a good piece of advice for anybody, you know, just gain that vision for you know what you want to accomplish, both you know, maybe career-wise or business-wise, as well as personal goals in your life and interpersonal relationships, etc.
Yep,
that's great. Well, you had a good tool. Your parents come across very supportive and very loving, and your siblings, and then of course all these people out there in your orbit that have been following you and that are you've been motivated to also give it a shot. So it seems like maybe there'll be a bigger community of domino artists and topplers. Which one do you go by? Which term do you use?
I use the term domino artist.
Yeah, that makes sense. That's what I figured.
Yeah. It makes it feel more of a legitimate art form. You know, people understand art. But toppler is kind of...
There are a lot of people out there who think... Go ahead, I'm sorry.
Yeah, people understand the word artist, but toppler is sort of like a new phrase that people might not get.
Right, I understand. Yeah, and also there are a lot of people out there who might think of dominoes as just, you know, it's a game, it's toys. Mm-hmm. They're right. But it's just your the colors on your palette.
Exactly, yeah.
Gotcha. All right, well, thank you. And again, Lily Hevesh is the subject of Lily Topples the World, directed by Jeremy Workman. And it's going to be widely available on August 26th and on Discovery Plus. And then it's going to be very exciting. So I'm going to urge everybody to definitely watch this entertaining documentary. It's so much fun to watch.
Go check it out.
It's so much fun to watch. There's so many great samples of your work in this throughout, you know.
Thank you. Yeah.
Never a dull moment.
Yeah, it just keeps going on every scene.
All right. Well, thank you. I appreciate your coming on. It was a nice little perk, an extra bonus.
Thank you so much for having me. Yeah, I didn't even know about this either, but it just, you know, timing worked out and this was a lot of fun. So thank you.
Yeah, I'm glad it did. I'm glad. And you're in New York?
For the next week, I am, yes. Mm-hmm. I'm from the Boston area.
I know, yeah. Okay, very good. Well, my best of luck. Not that you seem to need it, but it's always helped. So good luck.
Thank you.
You know, with the premiere and everything else. Mm-hmm.
Awesome.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you. And I'll say goodbye to Jeremy, or at least sign off with him. Is he still in the room?
Yep.
There you go.
Cool. Wow. That was. Hey there. Hi.
Hey, I'm back.
Yeah. Well, she kind of gave a little clarity to what a nice surprise, by the way. Who knew that she was going to be on my show? You know,
I know you didn't, you know, you thought you were just having a boring documentary director, and yet you got a bona fide, you know, YouTube creator.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. And she sort of did give me a good grasp on how she's able to be so present and so engaged and confident in these situations she finds herself in, you know, whether meeting her heroes or being on some sort of, you know, national broadcast or international broadcast, and she's so poised, or she's at, you know, some big conference or convention and she's talking in front of the group, but she's always seems to be able, or even maybe more intimidating, sitting in a group of toy industry executives who are gonna, you know, decide her fate potentially, you know, and she holds her own so well in those situations. I'm like, how is that possible? So
yeah, I mean, what was so interesting,
you'll see it in when
when people watch the movie, you'll see, you know, that what that we're in all these incredible places, like that, you know, she's kind of suddenly on shows and being invited to this and doing commercials, and it's just like this kind of non-stop parade of like kind of amazingness. And going to watch as Lily kind of navigates it, which is also really interesting because you get to know her. So you sort of feel like you're in her footsteps a little bit as she's doing that.
Right. Yeah. Well, well done.
Thanks.
Well done. In a series of documentaries, you've really managed to knock them all out of the ballpark, Jeremy.
Thanks. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
This one's neat. I hope people find it and kind of like get to discover it
Discover it on Discovery.
They can. That was a pun. Yeah.
So you need a Discovery Plus app.
Just
download it to your Apple
TV. Yeah, and Discovery Plus, I think they have like free, week free trials, and it's on Discovery Plus starting August 26th, but then Discovery earlier this year, they merged with Warner Brothers and HBO. So we don't really know what this means in the future for the movie, but we think it's all good,
Well, all right. Good luck. And we'll do this again, I guess, soon enough, right?
Awesome. I'm always available. Filmwax Radio is my, my second home.
Well, I appreciate that very much. It's been a while.
I know. I don't think we've done anything for a while. There was a pandemic,
There was a pandemic. I moved out of town.
I was finishing this movie. So, yeah.
Which movie?
Yeah.
No, very, very true. So, but, I'm sure there'll be other opportunities and look forward to them. So,
awesome.
Thank you very much.